Hi. In the last part, we have seen strain gauges and the way by which strain gauges can be used for certain force applications and temperature compensation, etc. Now, in this session, part two, let us see load cells. Load cell is a force transducer. It converts applied force such as tension, compression, pressure, etc. into signal that can be measured and standardized. As the force applied to the load cell increases, the signal changes correspondingly. In this session, we will be seeing few kinds of load cells such as strain gauge load cell, piezoelectric load cells, hydraulic load cell, and pneumatic load cell. Strain gauge load cell. The way by which strain gauge that is used in measuring load, that's the meaning. The principle is, in the strain gauge load cell, there are elements like there's a force element, force applied. That force is applied on an elastic member, and elastic member, on that elastic member, a strain gauge will be attached. So the strain happening on this elastic member will be transferred to the strain gauge. When the strain gauge is in a part of a Wheatstone bridge, there will be an unbalance of the Wheatstone bridge, that thereby it will cause electrical signals. So, the applied force will be transferred to electrical signals in the case of strain gauge in the load cells. In this session, we are discussing about strain gauge load cell that is used for sensing static load. In the previous case, we have seen how strain gauge can be used for measuring dynamic load in the case of a machining condition. Now, it is a static load. That means the applied force, this applied force does not vary with reference to time appreciably. That's the meaning. Now, in the strain gauge load cell, as we see here, there is force element, forcing, force applied here. There is an elastic member, this is the elastic member. When there is force applied on that, there will be strain happening for the elastic member. Thus, there are strain gauges attached on the elastic member. So, when there is strain on the elastic member, that will be transferred to this strain gauge. These strain gauges are attached a part of a Wheatstone bridge. So, if there is no load on this, there is a balanced Wheatstone bridge. If there is load applied on that, there will be strain happening on these resistances or strain gauges. There is unbalance of the Wheatstone bridge. So, you will get a voltage, and that voltage is an indication of the applied force. In this case, we can see that there are four resistance elements, that is four Wheatstone bridge resistances are attached, or strain gauges are attached like this. So, two resistances, that is strain gauges, are attached in the longitudinal direction like this. So, here one, on the behind there is another one, that is R1 and R4 are on direction. Two more resistance like R3 and R4 are in the transverse direction, this direction. So, obviously, when the force is applied in this direction, these two will be, this R1 and R4 will be sensing strain in this direction, and R3 and R2 will be sensing strain in this direction. And the strain happening in this direction is because of the Poisson's effect of the elastic member. Now, two gauges, R1 and R4, experience compressive stresses, while the other two resistances like R2 and R3 experience tensile stress when force is applied. At no load, resistance in all the four gauges will be same, and hence no voltage output. There is a balanced bridge from this Wheatstone bridge. When the specimen is stressed due to the applied force, the strain induced is measured by the gauge due to the voltage output caused by the unbalanced bridge. In this case, the longitudinal strain developed by R1 and R4 can be computed based on the equation, the strain in the longitudinal direction, by minus F by AE, where minus stands for show the direction, that is, it's a compressive stress. And transverse or tensile strain that is happening on this is, actually it is, tensile is positive. There is an element, this gamma stands for Poisson's ratio. So, the resistance offered by the R2 and R3 is an indication of the strain happening in the transverse direction, and that is given by the equation gamma F by AE. If one is taken as negative, another one is taken as positive. piezoelectric crystals can also be used for sensing load. So such sensors are called as piezoelectric load sensors or piezoelectric load cell. Piezoelectricity means when pressure is applied, electric charges are developed by certain material. Such materials are called as piezoelectric materials. These are smart materials because the effect developed because of the pressure are reversible, instantaneous and predictable. That means when a force is applied, it will develop a charge, and if the force is removed, it will remove the charge. That is, it has got a reversible property, and the charge is developed instantaneously, and the charge is developed in a predictable way also. So we call it as a smart material or smart effect. The smart effect, like piezoelectric effect, was initially identified Pierre Curie and Jacques Curie in 1880, and they have described it as, in the case of ionic structures, when there is unsymmetry arises due to force, it will develop charge, and that charge will disappear when the unsymmetry is also disappearing. Certain material family, like such as perovskite material family in ceramic family, will display this kind of piezoelectric effect. Examples of such materials are barium titanate, lead zirconium titanate, etc. In this, lead zirconium titanate, PZT is a common abbreviation used, is one of the commonly used piezoelectric material that is used in piezoelectric dynamometers or load cells. This will typically develop around 265 picocoulombs per newton. This is called the charge sensitivity of the piezoelectric material. That is, it will develop around 265 picocoulombs. Pico means 10 raised to minus 12 coulombs per applied per newton. That means the charge develop is of the order of 10 raised to 12. That is very low charge, but these kind of sensors will require charge amplifiers, and thereby these kind of sensors and the system are a bit costly. Force sensing by piezoelectric sensor can be used for dynamic measurement applications. Typically, it is actually not good for static loads, because we have seen the case that when there is a load, there is a symmetry happens. When the load does not vary, when does not vary, there is no unsymmetry. The charge will be reversed. So, the volt in the case of dynamic loading, this is a better practice rather than strain gauges. Strain gauges are used for static measurement, whereas dynamic loading, piezoelectric materials are preferred. The voltage proportional to applied force is generated by piezoelectric material. Piezoelectric base load cells are used in dynamic applications where strain gauge load cells can fail with high dynamic loading cycles. The piezoelectric effect is dynamic, that is, electrical output of the volt gauge is an impulse function and it is not static. As we see in the case of strain gauges, in piezoelectric dynamometers also, there will be a cell, the piezoelectric crystals are cut and placed according to the direction of force. Typically, there are three kinds of cutting done from the same crystal itself: longitudinal cut, transverse cut, and shear cut. Depending on the direction of force, these kind of crystals will be oriented so that that crystals will be sensitive to force in that particular direction. The features of these kind of piezoelectric load cells are, these are having fast response to dynamic loading. And the negative side is that it is insensitive to steady load. That means this kind of load cells, like piezoelectric load cells, is not suggested for static load, as we see in the case of just weighing, etc. That is static load when there is no changing load. That happens in the case of weighing machines and all. These are very costly compared to strain gauges. Another kind of load cell is hydraulic load cell. Hydraulic means are used to sense the strain or the sense the load. The hydraulic load cell consists of a container. This is a container. There will be fluid inside the container. On the top of the fluid, there will be a diaphragm, and the diaphragm is initially loaded with a piston. On the top of the piston, there is a facility to apply force. There are stoppers provided on the container also, so that even if the force applied is beyond a limit, this will go and stop here. That is, only a limited force can be sent. Beyond force applied beyond a limit will not damage the system. This oil inside the container is connected to a pressure gauge also. This pressure gauge is typically calibrated in terms of force rather than pressure. Now the working is, when the force is applied on this load cell here, the piston will apply a force here on the diaphragm, and diaphragm will deflect, and that will be causing a pressure for the fluid inside the container, and the fluid will rush through the hose and it will cause a deflection for the bottom pressure gauge here. This pressure gauge, if it is calibrated in terms of force, then the deflection shown by the pressure gauge is an indication of the force that is applied on the load cell. This is a functioning of hydraulic load cell. Similar to hydraulic load cell, there are pneumatic load cells also. The pneumatic load cell consists of, again, a container. There is a high pressure air supply device, like compressor device. There is a chamber. There is a diaphragm. On the top of the diaphragm, there is a platform on which force can be applied. The diaphragm is connected with a nose, a valve, and the valve is in contact with a nozzle here, an opening here. The chamber is connected with a pressure gauge also. Now, when air at constant pressure is applied to this chamber, and because of the opening, the air will be escaping through the opening also. And when there is no change in pressure happening in this chamber, this pressure gauge will not be showing any value, it will be showing a zero value. Now, while using it as a load cell, force will be applied on this platform, and that will cause a deflection of the diaphragm in this direction. So this needle will be going downwards by partially blocking the nozzle. That means the compressed air inside the chamber will be restricted to go to this opening. So when there is a restriction for air passage, the pressure inside the chamber will be built up, and that will cause a deflection in the pressure gauge here. That means the applied pressure and the pressure applied force and the force shown by the pressure gauge are related. If the pressure gauge is calibrated to show the force directly, this force can be directly sensed by this pressure gauge. This is the working principle of a pneumatic load cell. We have seen in the previous case the part about electrical resistance strain gauges and its features. Now, in this session, please verify you can answer the following question, like, can you illustrate the working of strain gauge load cell with schematic sketch? Can you describe the working of hydraulic and pneumatic load cell? You are advised to go through the learning material that are provided, and we have a reference taken for these two presentations. It is Metrology and Instrumentation by Raghavendra and Krishnamurthy. We have given the learning material in the online learning platform also. If you have any question, please post it in the platform. We will have a discussion on that. Take care, stay safe, and learn safely. Bye.